Hello, and welcome back. Today's video marks the start of a new unit, but it also marks the start to a new semester for all of my students at Marymount Manhattan. The first 9 videos in this series introduced many of the foundational concepts that these next 9 videos will be building upon. We'll continue our studies of melody, harmony, rhythm, and meter, and we'll explore how these elements are woven together to create the music we study and perform. In today's video, we're going to pull back the curtain on the remaining 3 types of triads, expanding our harmonic palette even further. And on the second half, we'll introduce a new host of solfege syllables, followed by a look at a brand new meter called cut time. So grab your textbook and get comfortable, and let's get into the good stuff. Over the course of the previous 2 videos, we've talked a lot about major triads. If you haven't already watched episodes 8 and 9 in this series, I recommend popping over there and reviewing the sections on major triads from those 2 videos first. In particular, episode 9 breaks down the snowman method to building triads in great detail, which we'll be using pretty extensively today. Now, if you're still with me, then I'm assuming that you have a pretty good handle on major triads. But, as I've alluded to before, there are several other triad types. In addition to major triads, there are also minor triads, augmented triads, and diminished triads. You probably recognize these names from our earlier study of intervals. Although each type of triad has its own distinct character and sound, they are also each bound by some common characteristics. By definition, each triad is composed of 3 pitches, which we refer to as the root, the third, and the fifth. The root will be the foundation of our harmony, and it's also the pitch that we'll use later on to label the chord. The other 2 notes in our triad, the third and the fifth, are added by stacking thirds above the root. These thirds could be either major thirds, which contain 4 half steps, or minor thirds, containing 3 half steps. But we won't be using augmented or diminished thirds to build our triads. It's these stacked thirds, and whether each third is major or minor, that will define the triad type, as well as its sound and quality. I like to think of each triad as having its own formula, a recipe. So we start with a major triad again, and here's the recipe. To construct a major triad, you must have a root pitch, another note a major third above the root, and another note a minor third above that. Also, look at the interval that's formed between the root and the top note, the fifth. In a major triad, this outer interval always forms a perfect fifth. Let's hear a major triad now. This harmony, even in isolation, has a sense of stability and consonance, and generally conveys a brighter tone or color than some of the other triads. A minor triad flips the recipe. Here, we form a minor triad with a root pitch, followed now by a note a minor third above the root, and another note a major third above that. Look again at the outer interval, and we see again a perfect fifth there. Listen to the minor triad. This harmony still has that sense of stability like before, but the tone and color are quite different. this triad seems a little darker in comparison to the major triad. When it comes to Western music in particular, you'll find that the triads you encounter are predominantly either major or minor triads. There are, however, two more types that you should know about. The third type of triad is the diminished triad, and it uses two consecutive minor thirds to build the chord. This triad is also sometimes called the leading tone triad, for reasons we'll explore in the next video. This one's built by building a minor third from root to third, and another minor third from third to fifth. Now, notably, the outer interval is no longer a perfect fifth. Rather, it's a diminished fifth, hence the name diminished triad. Have a listen to this triad now. Right away, you can hear a big difference from either the major or the minor triad. It's unstable and unresolved, largely due to the diminished fifth encasing our triad. Now, to my ears, its tone and color are sort of shifting or murky, but more than anything, it creates this tension that yearns to be resolved. Now, lastly, the fourth type of triad is called the augmented triad, and this one uses two consecutive major thirds in its construction. This is probably the rarest occurring triad of the four. From the root, we stack major third upon major third to build the augmented triad, and as you might expect, the outer interval here is an augmented fifth. Now, what's really neat about the augmented triad is that it evenly divides the octave up. Of course, it's a major third from root to third, and again, major third from third to fifth. But also, from the fifth up to the root is a major third. So as a result, it's almost impossible for us to tell which note is actually the root of the chord unless we have a little more context. Now, let's listen to an augmented triad now. Like the diminished triad, the augmented triad creates another sense of tension, but in a different sense. Here, the tension is driven by a tonal ambiguity and a sense of longing for the context that will help make sense of the augmented triad. It can also have this sort of kaleidoscopic effect on the music, serving as a fixed point around which the other harmonies can swirl and change. There you have it, the complete family of triad types. Let's visualize all of this information in one chart. Remember, in addition to memorizing these patterns of thirds, which you'll use to build each triad type, you really want to familiarize yourself with the sound of each triad type. Either practice playing them on an instrument, like a piano or a guitar, or try outlining the harmony with your own voice, by jumping around from one chord tone to another. You now also have all of the information you need to build any one of these types of triads from any starting pitch. Using the snowman method from the last video, we have just three simple steps to follow to build any of these triad types. Step one, draw the root note on the staff, and make sure to include the accidental if there is one. Step two, draw a snowman shape by adding two notes above the root at intervals of a third and a fifth. But don't worry about any accidentals quite yet. Now you should have the basic shape of a snowman stacked up on your staff paper. Step three, now we just have to form the correct major or minor thirds between each pitch as required by the type of triad we're asked to build. And that's where the chart that we just had on the screen comes in handy. We can do this by using the piano keyboard and counting up either three half steps for a minor third or four half steps for a major third. And if you end up on a black key at any point, then just draw the appropriate accidental on our snowman from step two, and then continue counting on to the next pitch. This three-step process works for any of the four types of triads: root note, snowman shape, and then accidentals as required by the recipe. We're going to take our intermission here today, and we'll have a jam-packed second half with our new meter and our new solfege syllables. So let's hit pause on the next screen if you want to grab some water, a couple of orange slices, or stretch your legs, and then we've got more knowledge for you after the break. Let's kick off the second half now with a look at a new meter. Consider the time signature 2-2. Until now, our time signatures have always had a 4 in the lower number, which indicated a quarter note pulse to the music. But now we have a 2 in the lower number, and this is going to tell us that we have a half note pulse now. The 2 in the upper number indicates 2 beats per measure. So each measure in this new meter will contain 2 beats, represented by 2 half notes, or their rhythmic equivalent. This is the meter and time signature of more dances, marches, and show tunes than you can count. It's found in styles as diverse as Afro-Cuban and Latin music, Baroque keyboard music, and John Philip Sousa marches. And it's so ubiquitous that it also gets a special name and time signature. You'll probably recall that 4-4 time was so prevalent that eventually people just started calling it common time, and we replaced the time signature with this symbol. Well, 2-2 time is so common that we call it cut time, and we almost always represent its time signature with this symbol. Now, this new meter also has really big implications when it comes to our counting and rhythmic analysis. When we break rhythms down into counts, we're looking at beats and subdivisions of the beat. Well, in cut time, a half note represents a single beat, and the counts we write must reflect that. Here's an example of how we count each durational value in a cut time meter. If you're following along in the textbook, the final page of chapter 13 has several examples in cut time that you can use to practice analyzing and performing. All right, let's bring it home today with a look at new solfege syllables. We introduced solfege at the very beginning of our studies together, and back then we learned 7 different syllables to represent the 7 diatonic pitches of the major scale. Starting from scale degree 1, the syllables were do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, and ti. And so far, they've carried us along pretty well. But as we continue further in our studies, we're going to start to encounter melodies that go beyond these 7 notes and start to employ chromatic notes, or pitches outside of the major scale. And for those chromatic notes, we're going to need new solfege syllables. We'll visualize this a couple different ways today, but let's start with just the syllables and the scale degrees. Here are the diatonic syllables we already know, and the scale degrees that they represent. What happens when we need to sing a scale degree that's been altered sharp? Well, do becomes D, re becomes re, fa becomes fi, sol becomes si, and la becomes li. Mi and ti, for reasons that are clearer a little later on, do not have raised positions or new solfege syllables for now. Now, bringing it back to our diatonic syllables, let's visualize things when we need to sing a scale degree that's been altered flat. Now, re becomes ra. Mi becomes ne. Sol becomes se. La becomes le. And ti becomes te. As before, there are two syllables that are excluded, this time do and fa. Next, let's adjust our graphic slightly so that we have all of these syllables together at once. In addition to seeing how each chromatic syllable relates to each diatonic syllable, you can also see which of these chromatic syllables are enharmonic to one another. Enharmonic pairs like le and si, or me and ri, become really clear when you look at it this way. For one last way to look at these syllables, let's apply them to the pitches on the staff. For that, we'll need two lines, one for an ascending chromatic scale using sharp signs, and another for a descending chromatic scale that uses flat signs. We'll use a key signature with no sharps or flats and assume that C natural is our scale degree 1. First, let's place our diatonic solfege syllables beneath each staff. Now, add the raised chromatic syllables to the ascending scale. Notice that the half step between mi and fa and ti and do makes it clear why we don't need the raised chromatic syllables in those two positions. Moving on, let's add the lowered chromatic syllables to the descending chromatic scale. And once again, that diatonic half step makes lowered chromatic syllables for do and fa unnecessary. There's a pretty easy to memorize pattern happening with these 10 new syllables, with only one exception. Raised syllables change their ending vowel to the letter I, and it sounds E because it's Italian. And lowered syllables change their ending vowel to the letter E, which sounds like A in Italian. Our only exception is the syllable re, which when lowered changes the ending vowel to the letter A, creating ra. Now, funny enough, the sight-singing melodies in our textbook actually don't employ any chromatic syllables until the next unit, and even then only because we turn to minor key melodies. I really, really love this book, but I kind of wish we had more opportunities to practice singing melodies with chromatic solfege. Instead, that just means that we have a little extra legwork to do to sharpen this skill, and that's all right. I challenge you to go ahead and open your audition book someday and find the melody with the most chromaticism sprinkled throughout. Try analyzing this melody with these new solfege syllables, being careful to choose the right syllable when an enharmonic option exists. And then sing through the song with your new syllables. Truthfully, this becomes a really great exercise, because your ears are probably already familiar with this melody if it's in your audition book. And that familiarity should help guide you when you're singing these new and less familiar solfege syllables. That brings us to the end of today's video. We unlocked three new types of triads, introduced a new meter and time signature, and we more than doubled our arsenal of solfege syllables. All of these concepts are introduced in Chapter 13 of our textbook, The Music Fundamentals for Musical Theater, and there are plenty of practice exercises in there too. Next time, we're going to keep with this thread on triads. Now that we've studied every type of triad in isolation, we're going to start to see how composers have been writing, altering, and stringing together these triads to enrich their harmonic palettes. So until next time, be kind to each other, and thanks for watching.